Hello friends, I hope you all are doing good. In this video on analog communication, I am going to start a new topic which is modulation. So I'll start with the definition of modulation, how it is done. Then after that, I'll talk about the advantages of modulation. And at last, I'll be discussing about the various types of modulation. So it's a really important video for analog communication, and stay tuned with me till the end of this video to get more details about modulation. So the first question in your mind is, what is modulation? I have already told you, modulation is the process of changing the characteristics of the carrier signal in respect to the message signal. So I can say modulation is the changing the characteristics of a high frequency carrier signal. So I'll be taking the carrier signal whose characteristics are constant. So if I change this characteristic, the constant characteristics, with respect to the characteristics of message signal. I hope you remember, the message signal is random. Then only it's a message signal, it's an effective communication. So the message signal is random and the carrier signal is deterministic. So we are changing the deterministic carrier signal in accordance to the random message signal. So this is the modulation. So if I talk about the block diagram, so I have a message signal, I multiply it with the carrier signal with the help of a device which is called modulator, and at the output I'll get the modulated signal. So let's suppose my message signal is represented by MT and carrier signal is represented by AC cos omega CT plus phi C. So this is my carrier signal. So every parameter of the carrier signal, so I can say AC, omega C and phi C are deterministic, and I can say MT is random. So now when MT, which is a random signal, is multiplied with high frequency deterministic signal, this deterministic signal would also become random, and the randomness is denoted according to the randomness of the message signal. So it's again a message signal which is in the high frequency. So I just converted this message signal to a high frequency signal. So for example, if I throw a paper, it would not go long distance, but if I wrap a stone inside the paper and I throw it, it would go a long distance. So the carrier in this case is stone and the message is paper. So if I superimpose message on the stone, so the message is superimposed on the carrier and then I throw it, it will go to a long distance. So I hope now you understood exactly what is modulation. So now coming to the advantages of modulation. So the question in your mind would be, why at all it is required? So the first advantage is, we are multiplying the message with the high energy carrier signal. So when it is multiplied, I'll get a high energy output which can travel to a long distance, which can make my long distance communication effective. So the next advantage is, So the second advantage is that noise can be reduced, or I'll get a better signal with a better signal quality at the receiver. So with the help of this carrier, I can suppress the effect of noise and I'll get a better signal to noise ratio. So I can say SNR would improve. So now coming to the next advantage. So with the help of the modulation technique, the multiplexing is possible. So the multiplexing like frequency division multiplexing and the time division multiplexing are possible. I'll be talking about the multiplexing in detail in my next video. So as of now, you should remember that multiplexing is a technique where I am sending multiple signals simultaneously. So if two of your friends are talking simultaneously, you won't be understand which one is saying what, or the voice would get mixed when it reaches to you. But multiplexing avoid this possibility and the signals can be transmitted simultaneously. So the next possibility is, so the next advantage is the reduction in antenna height. So we all know, we all have studied in our previous classes that the antenna height is equal to lambda by 4, where lambda is the wavelength of the message signal of transmitted signal, to be more specific. So when I have lambda, which is the wavelength of the transmitted signal, and then h would be the height of antenna which is required to capture this signal, it is equal to lambda by 4. So let's take an example of the speech signal. Speech signal is in the range. So speech or voice I can take. Voice signal is in the range 30 hertz to 3300 hertz. So let's take the example of the highest range. So let's suppose I am sending this highest frequency, which is 3300 hertz. So this is my frequency. So I know I can find out lambda with the help of frequency. So I suppose that frequency is 3300 hertz. So lambda would be C upon nu, which is 3 into 10 raised to power 8. So for simplicity, let's take it 3000. So it is 3 into 10 raised to power 3. So I just take it 3000 because my calculations now would be very easy. So it is 10 raised to power 5 meter. So if I denote it in kilometer, it is 100 kilometer. So now lambda is 100 kilometer. So if I need to find out height would be 100 upon 4 kilometer, which is 25 kilometer. So now I hope you can understand 25 kilometer height of antenna, it's quite unrealistic. So we cannot transmit this signal and we cannot receive this signal as well, because for transmission and reception we require practical antenna, and practically this height of antenna is not possible. So now coming to an example where I am taking frequency to be 3 gigahertz. So let's take the frequency, or let's say, okay, I am taking it in megahertz. We'll take gigahertz as well. So now when I took the frequency in gigahertz, that time lambda is equal to 3 into 10 raised to power 8 upon 3 into 10 raised to power 6, which is 100 meter. So height would be 100 upon 4, which is 25 meter now. So which is 0.25 kilometer. So this is somewhat practical. So now if I talk about next frequency, which is 3 gigahertz, so that time lambda would be 3 into 10 raised to power 8 upon 3 into 10 raised to power 9, which is 0.1 meter. So now you can understand the height of the antenna would be 0.1 meter upon 4, which would be 0.025 meter. So now you can understand your phone is also having an antenna. So on which wavelength it must be working. So I hope now you are clear which height we should need and which frequency we should need for practical transmission of the signal. So whenever I superimpose my message signal on a high frequency carrier signal, the height of antenna becomes practical and we can practically communicate to one person to another. So now coming to the various types of modulation. So the first type is analog modulation. In analog modulation, we have two types, which is amplitude modulation, and on the other hand, we have angle modulation. So now angle modulation is also of two types. First is frequency modulation and the second is phase modulation. So we'll be talking about all these things in detail. So let's suppose our signal is represented. This is our message signal. So message signal is represented like this. So this is my message signal. So now it's not starting from zero. So if I talk about the carrier signal, so let's suppose this is my CT. I drew the carrier signal such that the amplitude of the carrier signal is more than the message signal. So now this is my modulated signal. M dash T, I'm representing it. So now here the amplitude is modulated with respect to the amplitude of the message signal. So amplitude of carrier is changed. So here you can see the amplitude is fixed. Amplitude is not changing, frequency is not changing, angle is not changing. So everything is fixed about this carrier. But here amplitude is changing in my message. So here now you can see the amplitude of the carrier is changed in accordance to the amplitude of the message signal. So this highest portion is this. If this is EC, EC denotes the amplitude of the carrier, and this is EM. So this highest point would be EC plus EM, and this lowest point, this would be EC minus EM. So now this is my amplitude modulation. So now coming to the second type of modulation, which is frequency modulation. So now, as the name suggests, here the frequency of the carrier signal would be changed in accordance to the message signal. So now frequency is changed with respect to the message signal. So again, we'll take the same example. So this is my message signal. Again, I'll take a carrier of higher amplitude. So this is my carrier. So Now this is my m dash t. So now this is the output modulated signal. So here the amplitude would remain same. So amplitude would be same throughout the length. So from here the signal started, and here it is, its value is increasing. So the frequency would increase. So now at this point the signal started decreasing, so its frequency would start now increasing. So now here again it starts increasing, so the frequency again start increasing. So now this is the frequency modulation. When the signal is increasing, the frequency starts increasing. When the signal started decreasing, frequency start decreasing. Again, when here after this point, the signal again started going towards positive value. So the value of signal is increasing. So here the message signal again started having higher frequency. So I just made, so it should be like this. Actually, I made this expanded signal. So now this part and this part are completely justifying each other. I hope now you can see up to here it is increasing, after here it is decreasing, and after here it's again started increasing. So now this is frequency modulation. So now coming to the phase modulation. So here we have shown amplitude modulation. So now coming to the third part, which is phase modulation. So this is my message signal, this is my carrier signal. So now the phase would be change. So now this is the decrease in frequency, which shows the phase lead. And here we have phase lag. So now here this phase, so if this phi c represents the phase, this phase changes in accordance to the message signal. So now whenever I have change in the message signal, the phase would change. So here the phase is changing, the phase is leading, and here the phase is lagging with respect to the message signal. So I hope now you understood what is amplitude modulation, what is frequency modulation, and what is phase modulation. So now coming to the second type of modulation, which is digital modulation. But before that, let me tell you, in analog modulation we have pulse analog modulation as well. So we have pulse modulation, and in pulse modulation we have pulse amplitude modulation, pulse width modulation, and pulse position modulation. So now this is so now firstly I'll talk about the pulse amplitude modulation. So now here, instead of a continuous time carrier signal, I have pulses. So the carrier is having pulses of continuous or deterministic characteristic. So the pulse is having the deterministic characteristics, but it is not continuous. So you can see there are breaks in between. So this is my PT, So now, if again I'll take the same message signal, so this is my empty. So now, if I have to do the pulse amplitude modulation, what will I do? I'll use the amplitude of the signal, and in between I'll change the amplitude of the pulse. So here the amplitude was 0, so I am not having any pulse that side. So now this is pulse amplitude modulation. So now you can see the amplitude of the pulse changed with the respect to the message signal. So this is my M dash T. So now if I change the pulse position or the pulse width, similarly I can change the position with respect to message signal. Now here I am denoting the pulse width modulation. So here I'll denote the pulse width modulation. So here the pulse width would remain same, here it would be same, here it would decrease, it would again decrease, now it start increasing, it again increase, 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 now it started decreasing again. So we are changing the width of the pulse with respect to the message signal. So this was my pulse when this pulse is superimposed with this message signal. So now the width of the pulse would change in accordance with the message signal. So this is pulse width modulation. So now in digital modulation, we have two types of modulation. First is high frequency and second is low frequency. So if I talk about low frequency modulation, I have pulse code modulation, and after that we have delta modulation and adaptive delta modulation. So I'm writing its full form as well. Pulse code modulation, delta modulation, and adaptive delta modulation. So these are the low frequency digital modulation. We have already discussed the high frequency digital modulation, which are ASK, FSK, PSK, QPSK, DPSK, MRA, PSK, FSK. So we have already discussed about high frequency modulation, but these are low frequency modulation which we will discuss in analog communication only. So now I hope a roadmap would have imprinted in your mind that what is analog modulation all about and how we'll proceed towards the end of the unit. So now I hope you understood everything which I discussed here. It's just the introduction. We'll discuss about everything, which is amplitude modulation, angle modulation, the pulse modulation, and PCM, DM, ADM. We'll discuss about all of them in detail in my upcoming lectures. I hope you understood everything. So I'll conclude my session here. I hope you like this video. If you like it, share it with your friends, subscribe to the channel, and push the like button. Thank you.